Hello friends, welcome back. This is Mehjabeen. Today I'm going to explain the poem The Definition of Love, composed by Andrew Marvell. The poet begins the poem like this: My love is of a bird as rare. So he says, the speaker says, that his love for his beloved is of a rare parentage. It is of a rare origin. Is of a bird as rare as it is for object strange and high. It is as rare as strange objects. It is as rare, or it is as unique as strange and sublime objects. And the mission of his love is also sublimity. The mission of his love is divinity. It was begotten by despair, and this love, it was begotten, that means it was the child, it was the offspring of despair. Despair means desperateness, a state of utter depression, utter sadness upon impossibility. So his love was the offspring, his love is the offspring, it is the child of despair and impossibility. This is what the poet means. Magnanimous despair alone could show me so divine a thing. And he's saying, he's personifying despair, and he says that despair is resolute. My despair is resolute and it is firm, and only such resolute kind of despair could give birth to such spiritual form of love, such celestial, such divine form of love that I have for my beloved. Magnanimous despair alone could show me so divine a thing, where feeble hope could never have flown, but vainly flapped its tinsel wing. And then he says, he also says that hope, he's personifying hope and giving hope the dimension of a feeble woman or a feeble bird, you can say. He's saying that hope has no scope in my love. In other words, his love is a hopeless kind of love, and there is no scope for fulfillment. There is no scope for union. Where feeble hope is weak, and in his sphere of love, hope has no scope. Hope can only just flutter about its wings, its brightly colored wings, from a distance, but it cannot play an active role. The only active role that can play an active role here is despair. In other words, it is a love that is that is hopeless. It is a love that has no happy ending. And this is what the poet is trying to imply. And yet I quickly might arrive where my extended soul is fixed, but fate does iron wedges drive and always crowds itself betwixt. Now the speaker says that it might have been possible for me to reach my beloved. And yet I quickly might arrive where my extended soul, that means extended soul is the poet's beloved. So it might have been possible for him to reach his beloved and get united with his beloved in a physical way, but fate, but destiny does iron wedges drive. Destiny has planted iron wedges in the between the speaker and his beloved, and as a result the speaker can never hope to get united with his beloved, and always crowds itself betwixt. Betwixt means between. Fate always creates obstacles in the path of the lover and his beloved, and fate always stands in between the lover and his beloved, and that is why the lover cannot see any possibility of him uniting with his beloved. For fate with jealous eye does see, and he says that destiny is jealous of him. Destiny is a woman, is being personified as a woman. Fate is being personified as a woman with jealous feelings. And he says that for fate with jealous eye does see two perfect loves. Fate is jealous of the poet and his love for his beloved, because these two people are genuinely in love with each other. They are truly and in love with each other. They are very much committed to each other. And because it is a genuine, pure, divine kind of love, fate is jealous of that love, nor lets them close. And that is why fate does not allow these two lovers to get close. Their union would her ruin be, and her tyrannic power depose. Because if these two lovers who genuinely love and care about each other, if these two lovers happen to get united physically, if they happen to get closer, then it would mean that fate has no power. Fate has no despotic power. Fate has no tyrannic power. And it would mean an end to fate. And fate does not want that to happen. Fate always wants to exercise her cruel control over people who are genuinely in love with each other. This is what the speaker is trying to convey. And therefore her decrees of steel, and therefore fate has laid down some laws, some strict laws, some stern laws, decrees means laws of steel, us as the distant poles have placed. And that is why destiny has placed the two lovers on opposite sides, on the opposite sides of the world. Or in other words, they have been placed very far away from each other, just as the North Pole is very far away from the South Pole. Though love's whole world on us doth wheel, not by themselves to be embraced. So the speaker is saying that the entire world of love revolves around us. It is connected to us, but fate is so cruel that fate does not allow us to meet. Fate has kept us as far away from each other as the North Pole is away from the South Pole. Unless the giddy heaven fall, but the poet and his beloved might be able to unite only if the sky falls down. Only unless the giddy heaven falls and earth some new convulsion tear, or if something very violent happens on the surface of the earth, and us to join the world should all be cramped into a planisphere. And in order to unite us, the two lovers, the entire earth, because of some violent external force, the entire earth should be cramped into a plane. The entire earth should become one big flat surface. And only then it would be possible for the lover to unite with his beloved. But that is something very impossible. There is no chance of something happening. And that is why the poet feels that his love has no chance of achieving any kind of fulfillment. As lines so loves oblique may well themselves in every angle greet, but ours so truly parallel, though infinite, can never meet. Now the poet is comparing his love life to the love life of other people who are not genuinely in love with each other, whose love is not pure, whose love is not divine, whose love is fake, or maybe it is not love, but it is lust. As lines so loves oblique may well themselves in every angle meet, and such crooked kind of love will have every chance of meeting, because it is not a straight love. It is a slanted kind of love. It is, and as a result, slanted lines, like oblique lines in geometry, they can always meet. at different angles, but ours so truly parallel. But because our love is pure, it is perfect, it is divine, it is born out of pure and genuine emotions. Our love is like two parallel lines. We are like two parallel lines. Although our love is endless, although it is infinite, it can never meet. But we two people who are in love with each other, we can never, our bodies can never meet. Therefore, the love which us doth bind, and therefore the poet comes to the conclusion that the love which unites them, but fate so enviously debars, is the conjunction of the mind and opposition of the stars. So the speaker says that the love that they share is something that destiny is very jealous of, and as a result, this love is just a meeting of the minds. It is the meeting, it is the union of the minds of two people who are deeply committed to each other, and it is the opposition of the stars. But fortune does not favor this kind of love, and as a result, these two lovers are not fated to be together in future. And that is what the poet is trying to say. In other words, the poet is trying to convey the message that people who have genuine and deep and true feelings of love for each other, those such kind of intense love is not recognized by fate, is not given any kind of care and attention by fate. Fate is jealous of such kind of love, and fate only favors those people who enter into unholy relationships, and people who are not actually in love, but maybe they are in lust. So these people get the chance to unite with each other, but those who genuinely care about each other, they never get the chance to unite with their lovers. With this, I come to the end. I do hope that you have been able to understand this poem. Do check out one of my previous videos featuring a summary of this poem. Bye.